Hi everyone, and welcome to part 8 of Ask the Tough Questions. This is a series that we began at the end of 2020 on Deborah Rye's movement, or DRM, as part of our Lifeline Connect. And it aims to answer questions that are seldom addressed and are important for us as we live Christ-centered lives. You can find out more about us, Deborah Rye, on www.deborahrye.org. We also have a helpline number. This is for prayer support, for counseling, if you just need someone to get some advice from or just talk to. We do this in multiple languages, so please feel free to reach out on our helpline number, which is 8801-858585. And if you want to stay connected with us, I will be putting the link to our WhatsApp group in the chat window in a bit. Click on that and you will get added to our WhatsApp group and keep updated with all the activities that we have. So a few weeks ago, we had a very interesting session on the origins of the Christian church. We learned about the early bishops and how the political scenario in Rome influenced the spread of Christianity. If you missed that session, or any of our other sessions for that matter, do catch it on DRM's YouTube channel, where we have uploaded this and all our other recordings. I will be putting the link to DRM's YouTube channel also in the chat window in a little bit. Today, to shed light on this topic of the early Christian church, please welcome me in joining again in to shed light on this topic, please join me in welcoming once again, Dr. Rebecca Wasson. She is a multifaceted dental surgeon who calls Toronto her home and is currently working to get her master's in theology at the University of Toronto. She is passionate about comparative studies and also about working with people and answering the tough questions. She is also an enthusiastic apologist. So without further ado, over to you, Dr. Wasson.
Thank you for that introduction. I'm just gonna share my screen again. Please let me know if you can see it. Yes? It's visible, right, for you?
Yes.
Okay. Can you hear me as well, clearly?
Yes, no problem with audio.
Okay. Sorry, I'm just double checking here. Okay, so good morning, everyone. It's good morning for me. I always get confused. I think it's good evening if you're in India. So I just want to recap what we did in the last session. In the last session, I was talking about how the doctrine of the Trinity was codified. It was elaborated and put down on paper, and it was made into the church dogmas and the creeds that we have today. I showed you this slide of the timeline last time, the last session that we did. We know that Jesus spoke about the Trinity, he addressed himself as God, and he explained the doctrines of the Trinity to his disciples. And of course, Paul claimed to have seen the vision of Christ, and Paul must have also learned about this from Peter and the other disciples, and from Jesus himself. And from the disciples and Paul, we went on to some of the early church fathers, Ignatius, Clement, Polycarp. I told you that Ignatius, Polycarp were disciples of John, who was Jesus' disciple. And then we came to Irenaeus and Tertullian, who were disciples of Polycarp. Then on to Cyprian. Then we had the Emperor Constantine, who made Christianity, I'll put that as a slideshow. He made Christianity as official religion of Rome. Before this, there was a lot of persecution of the Christian church. And after it became an official religion, there were other controversies and heresies that were coming up, and that made it necessary for the church and the emperor to convene the councils, the Council of Nicaea and the Council of Constantinople, which together has given us the Nicaea-Constantinople Creed that we proclaim in churches even today, right? So the creed, as we saw the last time, you should all be familiar with it if you go to a fairly orthodox or a liturgical church. We reiterate the creed every week, and it talks about how the Trinity and how we believe in the triune God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. And we also talk about how Jesus is of the same substance as the Father. This was a controversy that was brought up in the Council of Nicaea by a bishop called Arius. Arius said that Jesus is not of the same substance as the Father, that he has in fact been created by the Father. So Arius was deemed a heretic. All the bishops, except two, all the bishops were against Arius' position. And then they ratified the creed, which says that Christ is eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, or one being with the Father, through whom all things were made. So we ratified that he was homoousion, that is of the same substance or the same essence of the Father. So we saw till that point in the last session. Now going on to another church father, he's also called a doctor of the church, Cyril of Alexandria, who was bishop of Alexandria. Now, I tried to establish the timeline for you last session, because a lot of people always say that the concept of the Trinity just came into being in the fourth century and it happened overnight. But I established the timeline from Jesus to the fourth and fifth centuries to show that there was a clear chain of teaching of the Trinitarian doctrine. Right, the Trinity has been derived from the Bible, from the scriptures, but it was also further elaborated, clarified, and clearly put down on paper by church fathers. So as we believe that the scriptures were inspired by the Holy Spirit, we also believe that the early church fathers were inspired by the Spirit in their understanding of the Trinity, so that they could write it down and codify it as creeds for all of us to believe and affirm, right? So Cyril of Alexandria is there towards the latter end of the fourth century. He was again a firm defender of the dual nature of Christ. Now, everybody was clear by this point, everybody was clear about the Trinity, right? The Trinity was God exists in three persons and has one essence and one will, one mind, so to speak, right? One mind, one essence, and one nature that exists as three persons. I clarified this last week, last session. When we talk about personhood or person, the term was called hypostasis. What that means is when we ask you what your personhood is, you would be asking the question of who you are. To put it very simplistically, personhood would define who you are, and nature or essence would define what you are. Okay, so we just want to clarify that personhood and essence was considered to be two different things. It was not the same thing. And that is why we say that although the Trinity is a mystery to us. We don't entirely understand how it works. At the same time, it is not a logical contradiction because personhood and nature are two different things. So we have established by this point that the Trinity exists as three persons with one nature: God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, three distinct persons with one nature. But something else happens when the incarnation occurs and when the second person of the Trinity, the divine logos or the word, became flesh. He took on human form. So by this time, the Trinity doctrine was established, but there were questions and heresies coming up about the nature of Christ. So Cyril was one of the people who defended the hypostatic union of Christ. Now, the hypostatic union basically means that in Jesus, there were two natures, a divine nature and a human nature. And these two natures, while they are distinct, they are not mixed up with each other. They are distinct, but they are joined, invariably they are joined together in a mystical manner. And that is what we mean by the hypostatic union. Now, to differentiate from the Trinity is, again, I'm telling you, it's one nature with three persons, but in Christ, it is two natures existing in one person. There are no two persons called Jesus Christ. There was only the one person, but there were two natures within him, the divine and the human natures. So because of the controversies about the nature of Christ, further councils were convened. We saw the earlier councils of Nicaea and Constantinople. The next council that was convened in 431 was the Council of Ephesus. It was convened by Theodosius II, another Christian Roman emperor, because at this point, there was a new heresy that was coming in, brought in by a man called Nestorius. Nestorius was a bishop, and he brought in this new heresy which had to do with Jesus' two natures. So up until that point, Mary, or the mother of Christ, was called the God-bearer. The name that was given to Mary was the God-bearer, because it was always believed traditionally by the church that she bore God inside her. Now, let me make that clear by saying that God was not, Mary did not create God. God did not come to be created. Then he would not be God. Jesus, the divine logos, always existed, right? He is one with the Father. He always existed. He has always been. He did not come into existence at some point. But what we mean by God-bearer was that the baby that was in Mary's womb was fully God and fully man. The child who was in her womb, the infant Jesus, was always fully divine and fully human. Now, Nestorius said that this is not possible. He did not want to accept that Mary was the God-bearer. He said that that is heretical, blasphemous to say that God was in her womb. So he sort of said that the baby was fully human, but at some point, the divine nature was added on to the baby. He was not very clear about that. Okay, he said that the divine nature could be added on to the baby, maybe after the baby was born, something along those lines. Now, Cyril was a key defender that the child Christ, the holy infant, even from the time of conception, was fully God and fully man. So Nestorius was deemed a heretic in the Council of Ephesus, And the result of the council was the codification of the core doctrine that Jesus was fully God and fully man, two natures existing in one person. Now, this sort of died down, but it did not. There was a further controversy that came up that resulted in the next Council of Chalcedon, which happened 20 years later. This was convened by the next emperor, the next Christian emperor. Theodosius II had died by this point, and Marcion was emperor of Rome. So he convened the Council of Chalcedon 20 years later to resolve the Eutychian controversy. Now, Eutychus was another monk who was teaching, and he was not a Nestorian. He was very clear that Jesus had two natures, divine and human, but Eutychus messed up a little bit by saying that the divine and human natures of Jesus were sort of mixed up, that they had become one nature. The two natures had become one nature. They were not maintained apart. Now, you might think that this does not really matter. What does it matter whether Christ had two natures or whether the two natures were sort of mixed up and become one? Now, the problem with this is if Jesus was neither fully God and fully man, and if he had become God and man sort of mixed up, that would mean that he had become an entirely different person. He would not be a full human. Now, if we are to believe that Jesus died on the cross for the redemption of sins, then he would have had to have died as a man, right? We believe that he came as the second Adam, a pure and sinless man, to take on the sins of the world and to die for the expiation of our sins. Now, if he was a mixture of God and man and he was not fully man, then he could not have died for our sins. At the same time, if he was not fully God, then he could not have forgiven and taken on the sins of the whole world. It was only infinite God who could take on the infinite sins of the whole world. So Eutychus was deemed a heretic in the Council of Chalcedon. And by the end of it, the Chalcedonian definition of the dual nature of Christ was made. Now, the Chalcedonian definition is not a new creed. We only have the one creed, the Nicaea-Constantinople creed, the Apostolic Creed as well, which is a smaller version of it. There was no new creed that came out after Nicaea and Constantinople, but this is a definition of the hypostatic union or the dual nature of Christ. Now, I'm going to share these slides with you so you don't have to worry about writing anything down. But in this definition, if you can see the main points that I've underlined, they believe that the Lord Jesus, the same perfect person in the Godhead, and he is also perfect in his manhood. So he is fully God, truly God, and he is also fully man. Truly man. So he has a reasonable or rational soul and body. He is of the same substance as the Father, according to the Godhead. He is also the same substance as us because he is a man. And that's why he's got two substances or two natures within the one person. So he was begotten before all ages of the Father, according to the Godhead. And in our time, 2000 years ago, he entered into human time and space. And for our salvation, he was born of the Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, according to the manhood. So this is the one and the same Christ, whose Son, Lord, only begotten, and he's acknowledged in two natures. So the two natures cannot be mixed up. They are separate, they are distinct, but at the same time, they cannot be divided. He is always going to be the God man. So we can ask, does Jesus have two natures even now that he is in heaven? Yes, he does. He is still the God man. If you remember that vision of Stephen, the martyr, as he was being stoned to death, he looks up into the heavens and he says, I see the Son of Man sitting there at the right hand of God, right? So Jesus will always remain the God man even now, because although his human body died, resurrected, and ascended, his human soul as well is still alive and still there, and it is forever now part of the Godhead. Now, these three guys, along with Cyril, they were called the Cappadocian Fathers. They were Eastern Orthodox Fathers, and they also formulated or codified this doctrine of the hypostatic union. They wrote a lot on this. Three men, Gregory of Nyssa, Gregory of Nazianzus, and Saint Basil. Now, Basil and Gregory of Nazianzus were siblings. They were brothers. Gregory of Nyssa and Basil were siblings. They were brothers. Basil was a bishop of Caesarea, and Gregory of Nyssa was the bishop of a place called Nyssa. So Gregory of Nazianzus was their friend. So these three Cappadocian or Eastern Orthodox fathers as well, they have talked a lot about the hypostatic union and how it is possible for it to coexist. Very simply, I can give you an example quoted by Gregory of Nazianzus when he talks about the mind of God and the mind of man coexisting in the one person. So you can ask, how can there be two minds in one person? But he says it's possible. But he gives an example of how the earth has both waters and light. So the earth has both rivers as well as sunlight, right? So water and light can coexist together on earth. So he says it's possible in the same way for two minds to coexist in one person. Another example I can give you, a later example, from Kierkegaard. Kierkegaard was a Dutch theologian. He gave a nice example for the hypostatic union. He talks about a king who falls in love with a young common peasant girl. The king falls in love with this girl and he wants to woo her. He wants to make her fall in love with him. So he's thinking about how he should do it. Now, if he goes to her as king, then she might fall in love with him because of his money and his wealth and his royalty. So he doesn't want that. On the other hand, if he goes to her disguised as a commoner, then his love would be based on deceit. He is being deceitful. He is lying to her. So he doesn't want that either. So the only option that's really left for the king is to actually become a commoner himself, to actually give up some of his royal powers, to give up his position, and to become a commoner in truth so that he can woo this girl whom he loves. And that is what Kierkegaard said God does. God, who is transcendent, he wants to woo us and bring us back to him, bring us back to a position or a relationship of love with him, which was lost when Adam sinned and when we all fell from grace. And to do that, God had to actually become one of us, not pretend to be like us, right? But he actually had to become human so that he could come close to us, die for us, and again, renew that relationship that we initially had with God. Okay, so we've had sessions before on the Trinity. I know that Dr. Jayachandran has thought about it, but just for the purpose of this seminar, we have been establishing how the doctrine of Trinity was codified through the ages. So this is Trinity in a nutshell. God exists as three persons, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now the Father is not the Son. The Son is not the Spirit. The Spirit is not the Father. They are three distinct persons. At the same time, they are all God. And this was the ancient doctrine of the Trinity that has been established by the church, by the Orthodox Church, and we still follow to this day, 2000 years later. And this did not come into play in the fourth or fifth centuries. This was taught to us by Jesus himself. And as I've established throughout these seminars, it has come to us directly from the Lord. Now, regarding the Trinity and the nature of Christ, as I already told you, I'm reiterating it again. The Trinity is one divine substance, that is nature or ousia, however you want to say it, and three divine persons or hypostasis. So nature is what you are, person is who you are. But when it comes to the dual nature of Christ, which is the hypostatic union, there are two substances, natures or ousia, both the human and the divine, existing in one person, who is the God-man, Jesus Christ. Now, I just wanted to give you a sort of diagrammatic representation of the different heresies that came into play, because they can be a little confusing, right? Now, if you look on the right, you have the box with the two blue squares, the two blue circles. Now, that is the Orthodox view of the Trinity that we have in church. That is the Orthodox view of the hypostatic union. I'm sorry. So the Orthodox view that we have, again, is that Jesus is one person with two natures, the human nature and the divine nature, right? Now, the human nature has a soul. The soul is the mind and the seat of emotions, the seat of our passions, right? So the human nature has a soul. And Jesus' soul, human soul, is eternal. So it is part of the Trinity Godhead even now. The human nature also has its own will. Jesus had his own human will. The divine nature also has its will, the will of the triune God. And he had a personality of God. If you see the personality of Christ, the way he behaves, the way he talks to people, the way he reacts to external circumstances, it was a divine personality because he was filled with the Holy Spirit. He was without sin. So his personality was divine. So two natures, human and divine nature, human soul, he had two wills. A will is your intent to do something, your desire to do something, right? So he had a human will and a divine will, and he had a divine personality. So this is the Orthodox Chalcedonian confession that we just looked at. Now, on this side, you come to all the different heresies. The heresy is when somebody believes something that is different from the traditional belief or the Orthodox belief of the church, right? The first one, Arianism, we have looked at it. Arian said that Jesus was created and he is not co-equal with God the Father. He is not a one substance with God the Father. Now, this was thrown out in the Council of Nicaea and in the Council of Constantinople. Then you came to the pneumatomachianism, and they said that the Holy Spirit is not one with God the Father and God the Son. They said God the Father and the Son are co-equal, but the Holy Spirit is not God. He is not equal. So this again was thrown out in the Council of Constantinople. Then we came to Apollinarianism, which was another heresy. Now, Apollinarius, he brought in the issue of the soul or the mind, right? And he said that Jesus was somebody who had a human nature, but he had a divine soul. Now, the problem with this heresy is that if Jesus had a human body and his mind and soul was divine, that means when he died on the cross, his death could have only saved us from our bodily or physical sins. His death would not have saved us from our mental or emotional sins. Now we know that as humans, we sin physically. We can also sin mentally. Christ himself has said that adultery is not just about physical adultery. Even thinking about somebody in a lustful manner would be adultery. So our mind sins as well. The human mind and soul is considered the same. The spirit is different, right? The mind and soul is also corrupt, just as the body can be corrupt, right? So if Jesus had a human body and a divine soul, then the divine mind soul would not have been able to die for us. So it was established that Apollinarianism is wrong, that it's a heresy. Jesus had a human nature and a human soul. Then the next heresy, Nestorianism, that we just saw. Nestorius, he was not happy with saying that Mary is the Theotokos or the God bearer. He said that God could not have been born in the womb of a woman. God would not choose to humble himself that way. So he said that while there are two natures, he overemphasized the distinctness of the two natures. He said the human nature was born from Mary, but at some point the divine nature was put on to him. So that was again thrown out in the Council of Ephesus, as we just saw. The next, Eutychianism, is the next heresy. And Eutychius, he had good intentions. He was going against Nestorius, but he sort of overemphasized the personhood of Christ. And he said that the two natures are sort of mixed up in this one personhood, right? So we have to be very clear that the two natures are separate and distinct. And finally, the last main heresy, which was monothelitism. Monothelitism talked about one will. It said that Jesus might have two natures, the divine and the human nature. They were okay with that by now, but they said that he had only one will, that he had only the divine will. But that again contradicts the scriptures where Jesus at many times talks about his own will and he talks about the will of the Father. That is the will of the Trinity, right? So there are two distinct wills mentioned in the Bible by Christ himself. So will is your intent on what you want to do. So monothelitism was again thrown out. This happened in the Third Council of Constantinople, which I have not really talked to you about. I didn't want to fill you with too much information. But by the Third Council, in the 7th century, it was decided that there were two wills. So the Orthodox view is dithelitism, two natures and two wills. Now, if you're going to ask yourself where all this comes in the Bible you have several verses that speak about the hypostatic union. They are not all together in one place. They are scattered all over. So what the church fathers did was they took all of these verses together, they studied, they elaborated it, and they made it into the creeds that we have so that it's easier for us to share the faith. So in the Bible, if you see, if you're going to ask me, does Jesus still have the two natures today? Is he still the God-man today? You have verses like this. When the angels spoke to the disciples after the resurrection, after the ascension, and they told them that, why are you standing there looking up into the sky? the Jesus who has been taken up from you into heaven will come back in just the same way as you have watched him go into heaven. So they don't say that he's going to be changed in any way. They tell them that don't worry, don't be sad that your Jesus has gone up. He is going to come back soon. And then the next verse, which Stephen says as he is being stoned, the first martyr, Stephen, he says, look, I see heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. So he sees Jesus as the Son of Man. So Jesus is still human and God. Both the natures are still there. For there is one God and one mediator between God and humanity, the man Christ Jesus. Now, this verse in Timothy is one that I often quote. It's a very explicit verse which explicitly talks about the man Christ Jesus. So he is always our intercessor between humanity and the Father, forever interceding for us with the Father. He is considered to be our great high priest, our mediator, and he is still the man God. So he is one God, and he's also the man Christ Jesus, right? For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. Now, if you're wondering if Jesus had two wills or just the one will, I told you that the established orthodox position of the church is that he had two wills, the divine will, that is the will of the Trinity, God the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, they have one mind and one will, right? Although they exist in three persons. So there is that divine will and there is his human will. So he says, I've come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. So he's talking about the Father, about the divine will. And then, of course, in the Garden of Gethsemane, before his arrest, Jesus pleads with the Father, Lord, if it is your will, take away this cup of suffering from me. But then he says, not as I will, but as you will. So in his human nature, of course, he was afraid. I know that this is controversial for many people to think that Jesus was afraid. But if we are to believe that he was fully man, fully human, then yes, he was certainly afraid of the death that he was going to face, of his being cut off from the Father on the cross and his descent into hell and all of that. But he still says, not as I will, but as you will, because he gives himself over fully to the will of the Father. And so Christ in that way was perfectly obedient to the divine will, to the will of the Father, right? As a human being, he was fully human, just like us, with all our frailties, all our fears. We cannot say that Jesus does not understand. Jesus understands all our fears, all our temptations, and all our weaknesses, but he still trusted the Father completely and gave himself over completely to the will of the Father, right? So he allowed the divine will to supersede his own human desires and his own human will. So that's the hypostatic union in the Bible. So I'm just going to stop here. I wanted to talk a little bit more about the church and the Bible and how the Bible was put together, the New Testament, especially how it was put together, because there are a lot of controversies on Gnostic Gospels, and a lot of people say that the church left out certain Gospels and certain books that were supposed to be there and all of that. But I didn't want to get into it now at this point, because I thought that there would be too much information going on. So I think there would be a third session where we're going to talk about how the church, did the church invent the Bible? Did the church invent the scriptures? We have now dealt quite sufficiently with the Trinity and the hypostatic union and how those doctrines were codified in the creeds. So next we're going to talk about the church and the scriptures. And hopefully we'll do that next month. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Rebecca. We'll open it up for questions now. Please raise your hand and I can unmute. I can see Sarah Wasson. I think you're trying to speak. Let me just unmute you. Oh, no, is it? Okay.
No, she's waving to me because she's my mother.
Oh, I see. Oh, that's it. Okay, so are there any other questions from the... I think people were asking about the PPT, the presentation.
Yes, I'll send it to them. Right now, I'll send it to them.
Okay, all right. Okay, let me just go ahead and unmute all so that if anybody has a question, you can just ask it now. Otherwise, we will. Okay, there are a couple of questions in the chat window. The first one is by Jay. He says, by being in Jesus Christ, can we become fully divine and fully human like Jesus? If yes, how? And if not, why not?
Well, if you're asking whether we can become God himself, we cannot. We are human. We have the human nature. However, the church also traditionally believes that when we resurrect again in Christ with our glorified bodies, and at that point, when we talk about the wedding between the Lamb and the church, we talk about Jesus as the bridegroom, and we talk about the church as being the bride of Christ. So as God always says that when two people are married, they become one. So in that sense, there would be a mystical union between the church and Christ in heaven. Okay, that does not mean that we are going to become God, but the Bible does say that we would be co-heirs along with Christ. Co-heirs along with Christ in the sense that Jesus is still fully man and fully God, as I told you. So because of that, we ourselves would become co-heirs along with Christ. We are co-heirs along with Christ even now. That's why we can call God Abba. We can call him Father. And that is only because of what Jesus did for us. Because Jesus became one of us, we have now become children of God through him. So in that sense, you can maybe say that we would become one with the divine, but our nature is not going to change. We are not all going to become smaller gods.
I hope that answers your question, Ajay. There's another one. Thank you for the wonderful talk, Subhi says. I would like to know how Jesus existed in the beginning.
In the beginning, Jesus was begotten, not created. Now, what we mean by that is that God the Father is the source of all things, but he did not create the divine logos. He did not create the word, that is Jesus, and he did not create the Holy Spirit, right? What the term we use for it is filiation, right? So Jesus was begotten, that is, he comes from the Father. But he is not created as we were created. Now, the difference there is that we are not necessary beings, we are contingent beings. So we are dependent on somebody else to give us life. Our parents give us life, God gave us life, and we are dependent on them to get our life. And also when we die, nothing is really going to happen in the sense that the world is not going to cease to exist if one of us dies, right? So we are contingent beings, but God is a necessary being. God must have always existed. He should have always been there. Nobody could have created God. If somebody else has created God, then that person would become God, right? So God is the ultimate first cause, the first principle. He's a necessary being. So in that sense, Jesus was not created. He always was. The Holy Spirit was not created. He always was. But they come from the Father. Jesus proceeds from the Father, and from the Jesus and the Father, the Holy Spirit proceeds. So that is how they have always existed. So it's almost as if God always existed in relationship. The three persons of the triune God always existed in relationship with each other. That is how God always has been. Ontologically, the nature of God has always been three persons. So he has been there from eternity. If God has always existed, Jesus has also always existed. The Holy Spirit has also always existed. If Jesus came to exist at a point after the existence of the Father, then we would have to say that he was created. But no, they always existed co-eternally from the beginning. So God is a necessary being that did not come to exist, but always was, and he always existed as three persons.
Yeah, I hope that answers your question. That brings me to the next one. It says, how come throughout the Old Testament, God never introduced himself as we are, but I am Yahweh? Jesus, the name Lesus, I'm not sure if I'm saying that right, Yeshua, Yahweh, Savior. So this is in the chat window by Chaco. Chaco, if you would like, sir, I can unmute you. So he says, how come? I have tried to, but he's not accepting the unmute. Okay. So, how come God has never introduced
Genesis, himself? Even from Genesis, you can see that God says, let us create man in our own image. So the term there in the ancient Hebrew is more of a plural term. And he says, let's create man in our own image. And you would see where the Spirit of the Lord hovers over the waters. So you can see the three persons acting there. And also there are these pre-incarnate Christophanies or pre-incarnate appearances of Christ in the Old Testament. Now, if you remember that time when Abraham was asked to sacrifice his son Isaac, and he was taken up, and then at the last moment, the angel of the Lord would say, Abraham, do not hurt the boy. And at that point, the angel of the Lord addresses himself as God. Okay, so theologians believe that the angel of the Lord, where it's mentioned with a capital A in your Bibles in the Old Testament, is actually Christ. He is called the angel of the Lord because people did not really understand the triune nature of God, because that was not revealed by God at that point of time. The revelation of God in the Bible, if you look at it, it does not happen all at once. It happens in sequences. It happens in parts. So in the Old Testament, there were prophecies of Christ, the Messiah, right? And you had these pre-incarnate appearances of Christ as the angel of the Lord, but it was not explicitly mentioned that God exists in three persons and all of that. That final revelation came after Christ himself was incarnated. God, if you look at the way he reveals himself, when he first appeared to Abraham, he will tell him about himself. He'll tell Abraham to follow him. But then even if you look at the story of Jacob and Rachel, they were okay with having other gods. Rachel, for instance, had her father's idols stolen and packed away in her bags when she was leaving with her husband, when they were fleeing from Laban. So God did not really tell them, chastise them, or he was not upset with them for having idols. But later, as the Mosaic law came, it was very particular that thou shalt have no other gods before me. Okay, so that does not mean that God doesn't mind us worshiping other gods. It's just that he chose to reveal himself gradually. He is not the sort of God who would come and force himself on you and say that this is me, I want you to drop everything and follow me right now. He's not that sort of a person. He's somebody who wants to build a relationship with us, and then slowly, as we become closer to him and as we love him more and more, we will start doing what he wants. He's not an autocratic dictator in that way. So similarly, God's revelation always came in parts. This concept of the triune nature of God, it is there in the Old Testament, but it's not explicitly mentioned.
So Chako has a follow-up question. John 1:1, how do you translate? And then there's a follow-up question by Subhi also. So I've unmuted Subhi, but maybe you can answer how to translate John 1:1, and then we can go to Subhi.
John 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Yes. That is what I was saying. So from the beginning, the Word, that is Jesus. Jesus is the Word, the Logos, the divine Logos. He was always there from the beginning. He was with God. So what that means is that they are two different persons. They're not the same person. But at the same time, the Word was God as well. And then the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. So he says that the Word incarnated as flesh, as Christ. So the human nature of Christ was put on to the divine nature, and he dwelt among us, and we saw him.
You can go ahead. We can't hear you. So let me ask the next question. It's by Paul Samuel. He says, thank you for this talk. This may not be relevant to the topic, but it could shed light on the right eschatological belief to possess concerning the second coming of Christ. The preterist approach says that many of the biblical prophecies in Revelation have taken place, that most of the events in Revelation already took place in 65 to 67 AD at the time of Nero.
Yes, okay.
I don't know what the question is though. Yeah, he's kind of left it at that.
Okay.
Paul, I have asked you to unmute. So if you can find the unmute button, please go ahead.
Hi, thank you for this talk. So this is regarding the right eschatological belief to have concerning the biblical prophecies in Revelation. Now, there are different views that I've come to understand people hold. They have the historicist view. And one such view is a preterist view, which I've been kind of grappling with to understand, because according to that view, most of the biblical prophecies in Revelation have already taken place. For example, the persecution, the immense persecution that took place around the time of Nero, pointed out that Nero was the Antichrist. And so in our day and age, we don't really have to look forward to like that sort of tribulation again. It has already taken place. So like the preterist view, there are various other views to hold. So I was just struggling with what view to place faith in. If you could shed some light on that, please.
Well, for me, I also hold to the preterist view in the sense that, yes, the prophecies in Revelation that John gives addresses the immediate problems that the church was going to have with Nero and the other emperors after him, after Nero, you know, Marcus Aurelius, and there were other emperors who persecuted the church greatly. So it could be taken in that context. So when we do biblical interpretation or hermeneutics, we have the literal historical interpretation, and we also have something called the quadriga interpretation. If you look at quadriga, there are like four ways to interpret any biblical passage. One is we interpret it in the historical literal vein. The second, we interpret it Christologically. We look at all passages as through the lens of Christ. And third, we interpret it tropologically. That is, we look at how the passage can teach us to behave in a moral way. And fourthly, we interpret it eschatologically. That is, how it's going to happen in the future. Now, if you look at the passages in Revelation, yes, if you interpret it literally historically, we can say that at that particular context, at that particular time, John was talking about those individual events that were going to happen in the church. But if you look at it Christologically, Jesus said himself that he is going to come back, that he has gone to heaven to prepare a place for us, and that he will return, the Son of Man will return. So we can also see it Christologically as the second coming of Christ and the judgment day and the new heaven, new earth, etc. Tropologically, the way that we are supposed to behave, we know that he's going to come back for us. So we live with the hope that we are going to see Jesus again, that we are going to be with him in heaven again. And we want to keep our lives pure and try to make ourselves more Christ-like so that, you know, we can be with him in the end. And finally, eschatologically as well, it all points towards the final coming of Christ and when all of creation will be totally reconciled and glorified and become the new earth and the new heaven. Okay, so just because we look at it historically and literally, it doesn't mean we cannot interpret it in the other ways as well. The Bible, we can take a verse in context, in history, there's nothing wrong with it. That is how theologians do it as well. But that's not the only way. The same verse can be interpreted in other ways as well. And there is a lot of context for this. For example, if you see Peter, when Peter is talking in Acts on the day of the Pentecost, right? He talks from the prophet Joel. He says, in the last days, the Lord will pour out his spirit on all flesh. Now, Joel was talking about it in some other time, in some other context. And why is Peter taking that here? Right? But he is interpreting it Christologically in this present time. So we can look at Revelation in both those ways.
Okay. There's one more question. Ma'am, thank you for the talk, says Sunil. Are there any council or councils to counter Gnosticism? Because they sometimes bring in the Father, Mother, and the Holy Spirit.
The Father, Mother, and the Holy Spirit is a Mormon church idea. The Mormons or the Church of the Latter-day Saints of Jesus, they have a different theology, although they also call themselves Christians sometimes. They have the Father, Mother, Son, and the Holy Spirit as well, I think. I'm not sure about the Holy Spirit, but they have the Father, Mother, and the Son. So they sort of look at it as a divine family of sorts. But the Gnostic theologies of old that St. Paul talks about and all, that dealt more with the Gnostics believed that the body is impure and earthbound, whereas the soul or the spirit is pure. And they felt that the soul cannot be tainted by sin. So Gnostic theology sort of led, not all Gnostics, but some Gnostics, they believe that you can do anything you want with your body. You can be sexually promiscuous. You can do whatever you want with the body because it doesn't matter, because ultimately your soul is pure and your soul will ascend to God. So there are many Gnostic gospels that were written later, like for instance, the gospel of Philip, the gospel of Mary Magdalene, etc., which were not the synoptic gospels and they are not included in the Bible. We'll talk more about this in next week's session. But yeah, those were the Gnostics. As far as I'm aware, I don't think any of the seven councils dealt with Gnosticism. The Gnostics were dealt with by Paul himself, and the church fathers, many of them wrote against Gnosticism. Even Athanasius and all wrote against it, but I don't think any councils were convened against Gnosticism. The councils were mainly convened again for heresies, the heresies about the hypostatic union and the Trinity and all of that.
Subhi, go ahead.
Hi, I had earlier asked a question concerning the nature of Jesus. So you said that he is God-man. So my question is, what was the nature of Jesus in the beginning of creation? And since you said that the God-man, I mean, his body, I mean, that is true even after his ascension into heaven. So what do you say about the nature of Jesus at the beginning of creation?
The beginning of creation, it was just the one nature, the divine nature. They existed as three persons, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
So after he was spirit.
I'm sorry?
So he was just spirit at that time.
He was spirit.
Okay.
God is spirit, yes.
Yeah. I also have trouble understanding that Jesus was begotten of the Father. Like, what exactly do we mean by that?
Since begotten, it's not... Begotten, not created. He was not created. He didn't, as I told earlier, he did not come into existence at a later point after the Father. Begotten, meaning that he came, he comes from the Father. He comes from the Father. The Spirit comes from the Father and the Son. Jesus comes from the Father. The Trinity has always existed this way. See, for humans like us, we have one, we are one person and we have one nature. If you ask me who I am, my personhood, I will say I am Rebecca. If you ask me what I am, I'll say I am human, I am female, and whatever makes up my nature. But God being the maximally supreme being, he is the highest possible being that can exist. So God exists as one nature or one essence, that is who he is, existing as three persons. It is not, we don't entirely understand how it works. We acknowledge that there is a mystery here, but at the same time, it is not illogical. See, it would be illogical if there is only one concept that we are talking about, but we have two terms here. We have essence, that is nature, and we have personhood. So one essence in three persons. We are one essence in one person. Christ was two natures or two essences in one person. So essence and person is different. So they can exist that way. God has simply always existed that way.
Okay, just a funny question. So if you say that God, like Jesus was begotten from the Father, doesn't that mean that there is a time point?
No, that is what I'm saying. There is no time point. If there is a time point, then he would not be God. But the Orthodox traditional church opinion is that there was no time point. That's why in John, he says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God and the Word was God. In the beginning, there was no point where they were not like that. They always were that way.
Okay, thank you for the clarification.
So there's one more. 1 Corinthians 15:28, Chako says, the sonship comes to an end. So I'm just reading from the King James Version. And then all things shall be subdued unto him. Then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him, that put all things under him, that God may be all in all.
Yes. So you, the difference here is if when you read about the Trinity, Trinitarian doctrine, there are two trinities that we talk about. One is an ontological trinity. Ontological is the way God is, his existence, right? Ontology is the study of existence. So God has always been and always will be one essence and three persons. There will be no change in that. The second trinity that we talk about is the economic trinity. Economic trinity is the three persons have different roles. Jesus is supposed to be under the Father, subject to the Father. Does that mean that Jesus is not equal to the Father? No, we are not contradicting ourselves. In being, they are equal. But Jesus is subject to the Father in terms of their functions. Like the Father sent the Son to die for us. In the same way, we talk about men and women. When we say that wives have to be subject to the husband, does it mean that men and women are not equal? Ontologically, we are the same. There is no difference. But in terms of running a family unit, the wife is subject, right? So now in the end, the new heaven and new earth, when everything is reconciled, everything becomes the way God meant it to be. The whole of creation is again reconciled to God. At that point, God will be all in all. There does not have to be, it's not that the Jesus and the Holy Spirit will stop existing. That does not mean that. It means that they will not have the different functions at that point of time. Jesus would not have to intercede for us at that point of time. The Holy Spirit would not have to teach us at that point of time because we will be joined with God in the mystical union of the church as a bride of Christ. We will be joined with God and we will know, we will have the heart of God and we will be with him. We will know all things. So Jesus and the Holy Spirit would not have to do the functions that they are doing now. Right now, they keep interceding for us because we sin. And the Holy Spirit keeps reminding us of all that Jesus taught us and comforting us because we are suffering in this world. All of those things, those functions, they wouldn't have to do at that point. That is what that word verse means. It doesn't mean that the triune God will become a singular God at that point of time. God has always been triune. He always will be triune. And he does not change.
Thank you. I think that was the last of the questions.